All right, this is your Cisco 2921 voice bundle unboxing.
All right. So what's the 2921 for?
Well, this is part of Cisco's ISR G2 series integrated services router designed for the branch, office branch.
Mm-hmm. And the model is touted for a 50 megabits per second full services on throughput, meaning full services being voice, encryption, WAN acceleration, and the list goes on and on and on. But technically it's capable of supporting
3.5 gigabits per second
of routing. There's a bunch of licenses in here. So Unified Border Element Enterprise License of 5 sessions and 5 more of the same, it seems. And there's a Survivable Remote Site Telephony License so that if it gets disconnected from the call manager, it could still function. And Communication Manager Express 5-seat license. Not sure what that is. You have any idea?
No, or SRST 5-seat license, okay.
Yeah, or
that's interesting.
That seems like an interesting combination to have, right? Usual license and warranty CDs, a rack mount hardware, of course. It looks like it's going to be a 2U unit when we finally get in there.
Just the ear style, not the full rail style.
No, it's not full rails, right? It looks like it's a 2-post style setup. Power cord.
And
the console cable is now a USB cable. Did we pay extra for this? Or it was probably part of the bundle?
I don't know. I think, yeah, they're $0 or $30, depending. I've seen different prices.
Yeah, normally they're making you pay for this because everybody has like a big box of these in their basement.
So this is what, it's a standard USB, and what's the other one? Maybe micro size, I believe that one is. I forget the name for the size.
This is a mini. This is a mini, which is like 2% larger than a micro. I don't even know why they built the micro. All right, so license and warranty. Everything that you could probably just download online. And a attention. Ooh, that ought to be good to read someday.
So this router runs iOS. That's the monolithic style software where it runs as a single process, which ties into something interesting we found in the release notes, which is that this is a multi-core processor on this unit. However, because it's running iOS and not iOS XE, it can actually only take advantage of one core at this time. It's one thread, so unsure of what Cisco's plans are, if they're going to roll out an iOS XE version for this platform where iOS runs as a daemon among other daemons and can be scheduled across, processes can be scheduled across the cores. It doesn't actually say how many cores there are, but as of now, the other cores are essentially disabled.
It says in the data sheet that services can run on the other cores, but I don't know if that would be true if iOS is, single-threaded as we know it is.
Yeah, I saw reference to that only a single core was active, so I'm not sure if maybe there's some differentiation on the documents, but I saw that where they called out that it is just single core.
All right, so we've got the Cisco black design here.
Actually, why don't you roll?
Want to go over the back?
Yeah.
We'll start with the front.
Yeah, let's do
that. All right, very well. So this is the front where no ports are. Except for the power supply. It's a single power supply unit. We have obviously it's a dynamically switching, so you can have various voltages. You don't have to get 120. You just plug your 240 or your 220 in there, whatever you have. We have the LEDs on board here. You know, system activity, power over Ethernet, redundant power supply, and power supply.
Integrated power supply.
Integrated power supply.
I think the redundant's an external on this unit.
Yeah, I haven't seen those provide a lot of value. We had problems with those in the past, but maybe they fixed all those problems. We have the back ports here. I'll hold it up for you. So this is a voice bundle, so just going over what's already installed. We have a HWIC, and it's a FXO HWIC, a four port. So FXO connects to the office, meaning we could plug this into a standard POTS line and be able to dial in, dial out, etc. You don't plug your phones into these, though I wonder if they make a model that you could configure the ports individually for FXS versus FXO. I'm not sure. But look, there's our console port.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Nice reduction of space there. You could also use the standard console port as well. Standard auxiliary port, gigabit Ethernet ports. Looks like we have 1, 2, 3, and that this one is a dual purpose where we can use the SFP or the onboard 1000 base T option. USBs, you can transfer files back and forth through that. Have you seen any other great uses for the USB ports on these?
No, just file storage, file transfer.
All right, so in addition to that, it looks like we have three open EHWIC slots for a total of four HWIC slots, and we have a service module, and we have the ability to remove this and actually have a double wide service module. Some of those the switching service modules can be wide, supporting up to probably 48 ports you could probably fit in there, but they probably do with something like a 32. I'm not entirely positive on the
service modules available. This guy supports a single width, one single width, or one double width. I don't think you can do two single widths.
No dual single width. But do you know how big the switch port capacity gets?
I don't know offhand. They have a Ether switch now that has features comparable to 3600 series switching. I understand. I guess there were some limitations in the older Ether switch. You can also throw a UCS module in there. I think it's what the E-Series goes in these guys.
Yeah, E-Series UCS can run a server inside of your router, which makes for great opportunities to consolidate local DHCP and DNS or even files and print services onto a server that runs inside your Cisco router. Talk about conservation of space. Is that it for the back here? Looks good. Don't forget to ground your equipment. Whenever you see one of these, ground your equipment. If you don't, you could end up having an increase in failure rates.
We also have our PVDM status LEDs that we'll get to in a minute.
Oh, there we go.
When we open up.
These are also compact flash slots here. They cover them up real nice with a little metal deal. You need a screwdriver to get those out.
You have the ISM status LED, which is the internal service module, which I think supported the services ready engine, which was another type of application support. Could support WAS and other systems internally. And we might see that slot inside.
Yeah, so that was like an expansion of like the old AIM modules where you used to put a daughter board down. Now they have a SRE, which I think has processor, RAM, you know, everything needed to add services down on top of the router by adding a different module. Oh. And there's the PVDM.
And I think there's one more use for the service module. I think you can actually insert modules that accept older series modules, the NMs or NIMs, I think they were called at one point. So they're backward compatible by inserting a module that supports the insertion of additional modules.
Okay, yeah, the NM adapter.
Yeah.
Yes, I think I actually have one of those still in a box. You wanted a new video. All right, so we want to open this guy up.
Well, I guess we'll try this guy here.
Okay.
See if that's...
So I think I'm going to remove these top three screws here, and hopefully snakes don't pop out and jump all over the place. So this being a branch level router, we talked about the speed and the throughput, but there was quite a list of series or services that could run on this, as well as a data sheet here with the specs, the base specs. What do we got?
Right, so it has integrated encryption hardware for IPsec, other encryption tasks. Let's see, we covered the external ports. 512 megs RAM, base, max is 2 gig,
Okay, so this is a tight squeeze here. Do I have to push from the back here? There's a pop up. There we go. So it was a pop up from the back. It's got some tabs in the front keeping it down. So kind of like your a PC, the tower, if it was standing on its side.
All right, so on the left of the chassis here, we see that PBDM 32.
This here?
Yeah, digital signal processor.
32 lots total we can have.
All right, yeah. Got the inside of our HWIX, or EHWIX, sorry.
And this is the compact flash area right here that you're seeing.
Oh,
right,
directly
that would below. That would sit underneath those HWICs. We have that HWIC.
Populated.
No need to take that one out.
So that's our DIMM expansion.
So we only ordered a base memory level because, you know, I mean, what was it? Only, you know, $3,000 for an extra 32 gig of RAM?
Yeah, right.
I don't know if they've gotten better about that, but that's been a problem in the past is the amount of RAM.
Oh,
we have some connectors here for the interner.
Yeah, it looks like a riser card, right? For the, what would you call that? A daughter card that would sit there for the ISM?
Mezzanine, maybe?
Mezzanine, yeah. It looks like it would encompass this area here, perhaps.
Yeah.
Maybe these are standoffs.
Yep, that's probably correct. It actually says press here. I'm not going to do that now, but.
Right, there's your ISM if you had one.
Mm-hmm. Looks like a single processor. Obviously, we talked about there's only a single core in use on that single processor, so probably I have not heard of them planning to release the iOS XE, but we did know that the 4400 does support iOS XE, and they released a whole new line of 4400 routers, which will provide multi-core performance.
All right. Well, I think that pretty much wraps this up. Cisco 2921V voice bundle unboxing.
Okay, we're going to power on our 2921 voice bundle router. Plugging in the power cable included. Power supply light goes on without the switch being on, by the way. See, it's green. So that might be a little confusing. Misleading, but you can probably tell.
Yeah, it says AC okay. I guess it's just
it
the AC. AC.
Right.
I guess we'll keep an eye on this and see when the power supply light goes on there.
All right, it's in a low fan mode, I think, right now.
Oh, and you know what else? Is it front to back? I feel it back to.
Yep, this is going to. This is
our exhaust back on this side, right?
Yeah, that's backwards, and we have that problem with a lot of equipment. You expect that the. Well, in this case, I guess the ports and the power are totally separate, so it's not data center friendly. Where in a data center friendly config, you'd have the power and the ports like a server in the same spot, and you'd have a cold air intake on this side and an exhaust on the port side in most configurations. So the power, the fan kicked up a little bit here, and I noticed the light changed from orange to green, but it's still a fast flash. The activity light is solid on. Not sure exactly what it thinks it's doing. It's not plugged into anything but the power. Here. I'm not worried about scraps in the little black here. All right, activity light and system light both top. Oh,
light just lit.
There you go. PS light lit and the ACT light turned off.
So we didn't kick into any type of a hyper loud fan mode. It's reasonably quiet. Probably wouldn't want on the desk, but certainly in that standard closet.
Yeah, sounds good for a standard closet. Obviously, in a data center, you're going to get a lot more noisier objects.
We're getting a good amount of airflow out of the front of this guy. All right, let's your 2921 power on sequence.